All right, we're here with Sunday Morning Coffee 220. All right, let me get into a little bit. I'm going to be truthful. Right now, I've just got zero aspirations of recording, editing. I've lost focus with the channel at the moment. And it's something I've got to recoup from. I've lost a little confidence in that matter, too. It's weird getting on camera, hitting the record button right now. And that's its own issue that I'll deal with. Up to date, shop closed down in the morning, May of last year. I brought all these projects with me when we moved out here. You know, 2017 was just a cascading event of just categoric tragedy or fault or misstep. Everything came to a head. So I brought everything out here. When this came available and we were able to move out here, I brought everything out here. And I stumbled along until April. And then April to through June, we stepped a little more forcefully, but it's still stumbling. Starting over is just that. So with the old projects, well, the shop ate me alive. Overhead ate me alive. People ate me alive. I didn't fire people when I should have. I didn't bring new people in when I should have. I didn't just gut it out by myself for a while when I should have. And there's a lot of faults there. And they all lie on my shoulders. So at the end of the day, it's my problem. So I brought the projects out, and I've essentially been in a debtor's prison for almost a year now that I've been able to get things progressing to some extent. Some people come and go happy, some people come and go mad. And that's through their perceived expectations. I try to pan out a broad view, the long view with folks, and give them the best expectations and most realistic expectations I can hand them. And it's not always a shared vision, and that's fine, and that stuff happens. But yeah, I put myself in a debtor's prison over the last year because I've been working the hours to get projects back to where they're in the black, back to where the overhead that ate me alive, and all these things. It wasn't like I was sitting at home on a pile of cash laughing my ass off. Through mismanagement, misstep, and some bad luck. Some of it was just bad luck or bad happenstance. So we're here. Cool. So Tony come out April. We were able to bring a helper in around June. And we've just been slowly building back, organizing, building a new model. Building a new shop entity, as it were. We got a nice little team right now that things are falling into place. The helper is coming along. Tony's stepping up and really redeveloping skill sets that have been dormant for too long. I have been able to step back from certain aspects, and I've been able to push some of the shoulder weight off of my shoulders, and it's shared. So it works. It's a partnership that's working. It's a good helper that works, who works his ass off. And we're moving very slowly, plodding very slowly forward. But it's forward. Each month we're showing growth, but not explosive. Now, just for let's get the logistics down. What happens behind the scenes? The work's easy. It's just work. It's time. How do you get from I want my car done to we're working on it and getting it done? Early in, I put out, it'll cost this much to do this. And it was very loose. It was very John Wayne, shoot from the hip, very Wild West. It wasn't very well organized, as it were. It wasn't what it needed to be. And it hurt. And it put me in big holes I'm still digging out of the holes that I put myself in the early onset because of this. The thing is, especially in restoration work, you cannot, absolutely, positively cannot just go, it'll cost this much to do your car. Unless you give them some obscene number and they they've got that to spend. But you put together an estimate of required commitments, material, and time. You set a budget, you acquire a deposit, and then you start going from there. You start hammering out. And most of my work, all my work, but there's two. Well, one light restoration. All but one piece that's here is on a time and material basis as we go, document, photo, and write down your notes, your hours, where you committed time to and why. Everything else is like that. Some people don't share that idea, though I get that literature out in front of everybody that comes in the door. I explain it to them, I get it to them in writing via email or hard copy, here you go, to try to winnow away some of the misunderstandings and misconceptions of what I do here and why. The reason why is a car can come in looking excellent and you may only need $200 of work, and then you dig into it and need $700 of work. I can't take out of my pocket, off of my kitchen table, to present someone else's dream to them. See, I didn't buy the car. I didn't decide to build the car. It was brought to me to do. So that's something that's a shadow specter that will always be there. But that's how it works. That's how it really works in any shop that's going to be around for more than a hot second. Because what happens is if you lock yourself into a commitment, you end up doing half-assed work to get it done faster, to make up time you lost, and it goes on and on and on. And you see these all over the car shows. You see these stories on Facebook and the newspaper. And everybody's disappointed at that point, because you've overcommitted and you're not able to perform those tasks. So there's a couple things. Update kind of what's going on. I wanted that scene, that sight behind the scene on why and how things work the way they do. The other is I'm out on farmland. This is rural. We're right off a main highway, but we're rural. We're we're 5 minutes from anything even remotely close to civilization, which is lovely for me. I'm enjoying it. Actually set up, I've had a pot, a little pot blaster, 80-pound pot for several years. It's parts of dry rotted, worn out, everything else. But I brought it out, got it set up, tuned up, operating well. So now I've tarped the hell out of an old dog run, because we don't need a dog run out here. Our coonhound Diesel, he runs around. He's leadless now. He stays on the property with us. My pit bull Smog, he stays on the property with us for the most part. He visits our neighbor across the road time to time, but he looks both ways and he's a good boy. They stay with us, so we don't have that worry. So I tarped the ever-loving hell out of it. The ground, the walls, the roof, everything. Buttoned up this dog run. So now I can take I got the pot set up in there. I got my reclaim set up in there. So now we're sandblasting. And using black blast. Black blast is important versus, say, silica. Silica doesn't cut well. It doesn't reclaim well. And it will kill you. Black blast, it's carbon. It's coal slag. The worst side effect, as long as you're not breathing it in actively while it's a big cloud of plume and dust, about the worst thing that'll happen is the grass will go wildly if you scatter it out in the yard. Cigarette smoking hasn't ceased. I haven't cut down, but it hasn't gotten worse. So there's that. I've tried a few times to go ahead and quit. It didn't work out. So yeah, the little things like that. So we're venturing out. Smith Welding will cease to exist in the not so distant future. I've kept the name active because I've got cash and carry accounts. I got my bank. I got everything set up as the entity, so I've carried it on. I'm gonna put all that to bed sooner than later. because there's other things. There's things to do, and I'm going to get the projects under the helm of Smith Welding buttoned up, and then we'll see what it brings. If I wanted to go lowbrow indefinitely, I could just do wholesale work for a lot. The nice thing about the particular lot I deal with is they sell pretty damn nice cars. I've never, doing wholesale work, doing it for, you know, I would do the wholesale work for cash flow to keep things paid and train people, help rough out skill sets and start defining skill sets in people. These fellows here, these lots that the cat owns two lots out here in small town Iowa. He lets us do most of our work quite well, comparatively, for a wholesale setting. So, I think that's the intermediate plan, is just get the restos pummeled away as we're capable, as we can afford to do it. Pay the bills, take the extra time or the rolls in the schedule, work on the restos. Because that's the best outcome that can be asked for. Otherwise, what, you don't pay your bills, you lose the place, and everything goes to hell again. I can't allow that. But at that juncture, my aim right now is just to take a step back, a deep breath, and do quick one-day, two-day jobs. Just breathe. Just relax. Do stuff that's not terribly important in my scope, not terribly important, and enjoy that for a little while. Enjoy the absence of the strain. So I don't know where I'm gonna bounce back on. I'll be around. I'll bounce back up. There'll come a time I'll get jazzed and jived, and I'll start cutting footage and editing footage, and I just don't know when that is yet. I've tried to really push myself, and at the end of the day, when I'm done in the shop, I'm just spent. I don't have anything left. When we get to basically two goal plateaus from here, there's a number, you know, because we've got business goals set up, fiscal goals and production goals. And that's a big thing. I didn't have real hard fiscal goals set up prior. And as we hit the goals, two tiers of goals from here, not the next set of goals, but the one after, some things will happen. One, the shop will be solvent, and we'll decide what direction it goes at that point. Tony and I will sit down, we'll decide that. Two, we'll have some time. We won't be just throwing everything at it, because right now we're developing the operating procedures that we are to follow. We're developing our product lists that we use. We're redeveloping, not reinventing the wheel. We're just taking the framework and fleshing out the details now on how it works best for the three of us to work and operate with the space provided. Like back in town, back in Des Moines, I had 6,000 feet. I could move a vehicle around 30 times and never go outside. Here, to move a vehicle, it's got to go outside and come back in. Well, when you do that, you have to decontaminate that thing. You got to wipe it down with prep salt, otherwise you're going to end up with mystery fisheye and swirls and God knows what. We've experienced it. We hit our head against that wall a few times. And I never thought about it that way, but I'm like, I'm introducing it to the bigger environment outside versus just in the shop, the closed environment of the shop. And that's not conducive to doing good paint work, not conducive to doing good body work. So we're finding out what hurdles it is we have to deal with the space provided. And we're going through and we're dealing with all those aspects. But like I said, the sandblast setup, you know, we're refinishing wheels. The lovely thing of it is I can take and clean up parts in an hour that would take someone a day to scrub by hand and use $20-$30 of abrasives and chemicals. So reducing time spent in getting a better product, reducing money spent in getting a better product, it's always, you know, that's always a win, that's always the goal. But the next big goal is get the restos pushed. Relax, do simple work for a while. Bank up some capital for our next move. And start investing in some more equipment. A good brake, a stump shear, a bead roller. These things are the direction and scope that we're aiming. These are necessary. That's kind of where we're at. I spent over 15 minutes. I'm going to let y'all go. I'm going to finish my cigarette and go in and enjoy the family. I will talk to you all later.